Lord, and I'm drowning in your sea of forgetfulness. The chains of yesterday surround me. I yearn for peace and rest. I don't want to end up where you found me. And it echoes in my mind, keeps me awake tonight. I know you cast my sin as far as the east is from the west. And I stand before you now as though I've never sinned. Today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west, from one scarred hand to the other.
Please be seated. Good morning. We've come here together today to worship and also to praise and also to give thanks. Today is our annual graduation Sunday, where we celebrate the achievements of those who've put time and effort, have expended brain cells and energy, late nights, long hours, in order to achieve a goal. It's always good in life to have a goal. To be purposeless is to be goalless. And I think it was Socrates that said that when one fails to reflect on the purpose of life, it's a life of meaningless. And so we come here together today to congratulate and to encourage and to celebrate the achievements of these four graduates. But first, let us begin with a word of prayer. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for today that we can gather together in the name of Christ and the house of Christ, the people of Christ, and celebrate really what Christ symbolizes in our lives. Lord, he is the object, he is the source, and he is the goal of life. For all of those who would come to know God must come through Christ. Lord, I pray that each and every one of these graduates and these that are here today and those that would watch online would know Christ and be known by Christ, and that would be the tune, that would be the drumbeat, that would be the heartbeat of these people's lives, that Jesus would be glorified, not men, that achievements would be great, but Christ would be greater than all these things, and that it would be him that we would live and strive to please all the days of our lives. It's in Jesus' precious name I do pray. Now, I told these graduates, all except for one, that the purpose of their being here today on this stage was to be thoroughly and equally embarrassed. Sometimes you get nervous in places like this, in situations like this, and I said that just to be funny intentionally, but we do want to recognize each one of these graduates and their accomplishments, and then we want to give them a thorough lecture as it is. You know, in places and times like these, you cannot miss the moment, the opportunity to pass on a word of encouragement as well as a word of instruction. And so what I would like to do first is to introduce each one of these individuals and then give them a small gift as a token of our esteemed appreciation for their achievement, and then have them sit down here in the bullpen, so to speak, and to receive what is duly coming to them. But I want to say this before we get too far. Confession is good for the soul, but bad for the reputation sometimes. I had an idea of what to do today, but at 4 o'clock in the morning, the Lord said, no, that's not good. That's not the best thing. And so as I'm speaking today, go back to your graduation, that moment, and get to that moment right there, and enter into what's being said to these specifically, because it is just as applicable to you today, no matter whether it's been 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, and I know there's some of them that it might even be 60 years plus here today. It's just as applicable to you. And so, without further ado, a young man that I've just recently come to know, Mr. Carson Lorick here, he's a graduate of the business program at UNCW, Bachelor of Business, and also another person here on this stage with a similar major in design and analytics today. And so Carson graduated in 2023, May 12th, with a Bachelor's of Science, or is it Art?
Science.
Bachelor of Science. It's got to be particular here. Bachelor of Science in Business Administration, with an emphasis in analytics, correct? Plans to go this fall and begin his master's program, which also someone else here on this stage is also doing. And so you have some good company here. And I'm sure if someone would have a question, Miss Ashley would be willing to lend your assistance and get some pointers from her. But as a token of our affection for what you've done, dedication and energy that you've expended, we extend from Lake Forest Baptist Church this gift of appreciation.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Now, this young lady also come here about a year ago, thereabouts in that range, somewhere around when the whole 2840 whatever zip code back there had come. The Taylor Ivy clan, you know, in that range. And so Morgan Sneeden graduated Brunswick Community College with associates in nursing and plans to continue that education at UNCW, pursuing a Bachelor of Science in nursing as well. And darling, you know, the one good thing about Morgan is she's huggable. That's right. I appreciate them very much. They're very encouraging. So it's with our esteem, appreciation for the energy. And I know that, you know, working and going to school is not easy. And so we see that. We know that you extended many hours. And much to your amazement, sometimes things went much better. And we thank the Lord for that. And we extend this gift to you as an appreciation for the hard work that you've expended in that. You're welcome, sweetheart. Now, Miss Serenity, could you come see me? No? Serenity has achieved the achievement of passing the third grade. Now, we don't all the time think about these things, kindergarten, first, second, third grade, and whatnot. But we know that Serenity came to us through Eric and Alexa, and they have loved on her. And they have helped her. If you've been around for a while Serenity's been here, you know that you've seen the change that love and kindness and gentleness have put into her life. And so today we celebrate, somewhat out of character, but we celebrate with Alexa and Eric what God has done in this little one's life. And we look forward to not only today, celebrating today, what the future holds in this young lady's life. And so, Serenity, you remember what you did this morning? You came into my office and you dropped that penny on the ground. She made me say that saying about good luck for life. Well, that's what we give to you today, a little gift, a token of our love, and we wish you a happy life and a well life in Jesus' name. Can I have a hug? Now, to another little one, which is over time grown very large in stature, not in this way, graduating this past December with her Bachelor in Science, Business Administration with an emphasis in analytics, currently enrolled, and hopefully this December will finish her master's degree with the emphasis in business analytics as well, Miss Ashley Savannah Davis, which I remember just showing her mom recently little pictures of way back when, you know, just after her birth at the Sound at the beach. And now here she is going to graduate in a short time with her master's degree. And how proud we are of you. And we also know that she is a very studious student in her undergraduate. And unlike me, who graduated old Lottie, she graduated summa cum laude, which is the top of the heap. And I know mom and dad are super proud. You know, it's when you graduate anything and you make an achievement, and when you stand head and shoulders above others and recognized by our own fellows as well with an award in the School of Business, it says a lot. You're a beautiful young lady. Your future is bright. You have a great brain. You apply yourself, and we can only wish that that would continue throughout your life. And this really is a token of our appreciation for what you've done. And we realize that mom and dad had a great influence in that, but you've actually worked real hard, and we want to recognize you today. And thank you. So now I want to have all the graduates, if they would, come down to the front pew and be seated. It's customary in times like this for the person who gives the commencement speech or graduation speech, whatever you might call it, to give words of wisdom or affirmation or encouragement to those who've graduated. And so though I might look many times at these folks down here on the front pew, again, I want you to go back in your memory to that day, that special occasion. Maybe it was high school or college or whatnot. And I want you to go back there, and I want you to listen as if I am speaking directly to you as well. Today, I want to begin not with my words, but words of Chief Justice John Roberts, who delivered a commencement address on June 3rd, 2017. He did that to the Cardigan Mountain School, and he said this, and I quote, "Now, the commencement speakers will typically wish you good luck and extend good wishes to you. I will not do that. I'll tell you why. From time to time in the years to come, I hope that you will be treated unfairly so that you will come to know the value of justice. I hope that you will be treated, suffer betrayal, because then you will learn what true loyalty is. Sorry to say, but I hope you will be lonely from time to time, so do not take friends for granted. I hope you bad luck, again, from time to time, so that you will be conscious of the role that chance plays in your life and that your success is not completely deserved, all of your own. I hope that you might have failures from time to time that you would feel were undeserved, yet would make you a better person. And when you lose from time to time, as you will, that your opponent will gloat over your failure. And that way you will understand better the role of sportsmanship, even in life. I hope that you will be ignored from time to time so that you will understand the importance of listening to others. And I hope that you will have enough pain to learn compassion in your life. Well, I wish these things to you, whether they will happen or not, who knows? Whether you'll benefit from them or not, should they happen, is up to you." Now, commencement speakers are also expected to give some advice. Again, this is the words of John Roberts. They give grand advice, and they give you some useful tips. And the most common advice that they give is this, that you should be yourself. Well, I disagree. In a certain sense, you should not try to be not yourself and be yourself. However, you should try to be something better. People say be yourself because they want you to resist the impulse to conform to what others want you to be. But you can't be yourself if you don't know who you are. And you can't learn who you are unless you learn to think about it. The Greek philosopher Socrates said, "The unexamined life is not worth living." And while "just do it" might seem like a good motto for most things, it's not a good motto when you're trying to figure out how to live and what life is before you. That's because the best way to lose your values that are central to who you are is, frankly, to not think about them at all. And so ends the words of John Roberts. By the way, these words were spoken on June 3rd, 2017 at the Cardigan Mountain School in New Hampshire, which is a boarding school for boys up to grade 6. Dr. Bennett used to say, "Men, if you preach at an 8th grade level, the congregation will understand you and so will the college graduates." That was supposed to be a little funny. Roberts went on, and you can find his remarks online. They're all over published online. And went on to make other great remarks, focusing on Christianity as being the source for one's strength and the impetus for one's life. But I'll not quote his words. Now it's Pastor Burt's turn. What I want you to understand, graduates today, and those that are here, is that hard work and perseverance and dedication and determination and all these things will only take you so far in this life. One's moxie, one chutzpah, all these other things that we would say that are valuable in the character of a person's life are vain and shallow compared to knowing Jesus Christ. I heard even today on the way here, R.C. Sproul say something that I never heard before, never heard explained quite this way. And I want to tell you that when Jesus said, "It is better for you to go, for unless I go, the Comforter will not come unto you," that word Comforter I heard explained in the way that I never heard it today. And for all of us here, and these graduates in particular, in beginning of life, we need to understand that as a Christian, that God has provided something through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and the ascension for each one of us that is better than one's own determination, stronger and more deliberate in what he does and what he can do than any strength that we can muster up all of our own. And that is the word Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Paraclete, the one who comes alongside, the one who lives. And for everyone here today, we need to understand that that word just doesn't mean what we in today's English would think would be, oh, the one that would come and wipe the tears away from your eyes. Like Robert said, life will be unfair. But what do you do when life is unfair? Is as important as the fact that life might be unjust and unfair. The phrase is, when you are given lemon, that you make lemonade. Well, that only goes so far. The word in Latin comes from two different words. One means with, and one means strength or power. That's what the word really means when you do the etymological study on the word comfort and comforter that's in the scripture. And what we get with the Holy Spirit is the one who will be with us and in us and never leave us, that brings strength and power when life gets unfair, when friends abandon us, when we feel that we don't have the strength to go on. He's the one. And it's only because of Jesus in your relationship that you have that which many others do not have today. So today, while we celebrate your achievement, we also want to think back. Of all the things that have been said, we need to think back. Because when you get a little bit later in life, you'll realize that you don't stand by yourself, but you stand on the shoulders of many others that have preceded you. And so I want to just think back a little bit. Jesus talked about relationships a lot. As a matter of fact, he was asked in Luke, that's our verse today, Luke 10:27. He was asked what the most important command was, and he said this: "You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your strength, and with all of your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And today, I want to point out to you that Jesus takes this verse out of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, and he adds a word to it. So he appends it and adds this word, mind. You go back to Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, and the word mind's not there. It says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might." Jesus adds the word mind here because he understands that's where the battleground is for the heart and soul of men. Just like in Genesis chapter 3, it says, when Eve saw, that's a metaphorical use of the word vision or seeing. It means when she reasoned in her mind and she understood in the intellect of her mind, when she saw that it was good to make one wise. Education is good to make one wise, but it doesn't keep one from being a fool. When she saw that it was good to make one wise, she took of it and ate and gave it to her husband Adam. Jesus zeroes in on this idea of the mind. And what you've been doing, college graduates, third grade graduates, what you've been doing is you've been straining the mind to learn and put things in there and to ingrain and to memorize things that will be building blocks for your entire life. Let me tell you, the mind sometimes is a dangerous place. Because what you put into it, everything through the eye gate, through the ear gate, it never goes away. It will never go away, young men, the things that you see. It will never go away, young ladies, the things that you see. Some of us that are a little bit older and maybe a little grayer, we can testify that those things never go away. They come back. And the devil, Satan, he will war in the mind. He will war against you in the mind. And that's his battleground. When he said that you must love him with all your mind, what he is saying essentially is that you must keep the first things first. At the core of who you are as a child of Christ, at the core of who you are as a disciple, and that means pupil or learner, student of Christ, to keep the first things first in the mind. Romans chapter 12, that we should present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and devoted to him, which is our reasonable act of service, and that we should renew our mind, verse 2. Renew our mind daily. Every day is graduation day. When the evening closes, the day is gone, the morning opens, and your eyes see the dawn of the new day. It's a new day in the school of God's life, right here and now. This graduation is a milestone in your life, and you'll remember it all the days. There'll be a plaque on the wall, a ring probably on your finger, and you'll celebrate, and that's all fine. But every day is a day of application and a day of learning. It never ceases. And the battle is in the mind, and we must discipline the mind to keep the first things first. And the worst thing that can happen to us is that we can get high on pride of achievement and forget whose shoulders we have stood on to come to be who and where we are. I'm reminded of several verses in Ecclesiastes chapter 12 that Solomon's believed to be the writer there. The wisest man ever lived on earth. If you read through Ecclesiastes, you can see the pain in the writings and in the words, and you can feel his heart of all the sorrows of the vanities after vanities of searching through life for all these entertainment and these pleasures. And he comes to the end of the book, and he says this in verse 1 of chapter 12. He says, remember also your creators in the days of your youth. Do you hear that? In the days of your youth. Remember him then. Don't put him off now. Don't put him off now. Why? It says, remember him in the days of your youth before the days become evil. They'll come. There will be evil days that will come. There'll be hardship. There'll be betrayal. There'll be all kinds of things that will come that will make the day evil. Remember him before they become evil. And they will actually make you say, I have no delight in them. I have a lot of experience in a congregation that's primarily older. And I can tell you, when you get to that older age, there's a many a people that despise the day. That life has no more joy. That's sad. Because they've not kept the first things first. Start young, train, discipline the mind to keep the first things first. And the joy of the Lord will be what you have. Peace I leave with you. Not the peace of this world, but I give you my peace. Joy inexpressible. From who? The indwelling person of the Holy Spirit. Discipline yourself to honor the Lord in the days of your youth. And trust. Trust. The author of Proverbs, probably Solomon again, says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. That word is lev in Hebrew, and what it literally means is the totality of what it means to be a person. It's not just talking about this mechanical device, this bioelectrical mechanical device here. The heart is talking about the totality of what it is to be a person with all of your mind, with all of your strength, with all of your soul, with all of your spirit, with everything that is, with your intellect. Love the Lord. Trust him. Trust him. Don't lean on your own understanding. There's going to come times when pragmatism comes into play and it seems reasonable. Utilitarianism comes in. Monetary choices, career, this job versus that job, and it's going to look right. Sometimes God asks us to do some of the most ridiculous things in life
It just doesn't make sense. I can tell you in 2006 when I sit through matriculation in Southeastern College, I was just heartbroken at all the stories of people that just got up and left and went and said, this is what the Lord said. Left home, family, jobs, penniless. I know people personally. Some of them are here today. God will ask you to do some amazing things in life. But you won't if you don't trust Him with all of your heart. Know Him. Trust Him. Devote yourself and put the first things first. Abraham, we know the story. Sitting at home, minding his own business, counting his camels. Get up and go to a land which I will show you, and I'll make you a great people. Had a barren wife. Made no sense. And look what happened. Because of obedience. Because he trusted. Chapter 15 or 17, I don't remember what it was. God comes to him and reiterates the promise. And he says, okay, Lord, I believe. And then the Lord says, it was reckoned to him as righteousness because Abraham believed. He trusted. Trust the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. Acknowledge Him in all your ways. Not some of your ways, all of your ways. All of your ways. Not just on Sunday. Not just in church. At work. When you're at home. And leisure. Always trust the Lord. Follow Him always. And there'll be times when it gets hard, when a decision needs to be made, and you won't have the strength to do it. It's easier not to do what you know you need to do than to do that. Paul said that. Why is it I do the things I don't want to do, and yet the things that I know that I need to do, I don't? Chapter 7, Romans. Oh, wretched man that I am, who would deliver me from this body of sin, he said. I think there's an Old Testament quote here that's somewhat relevant. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, he does not become weary or tired, and his understanding is unsearchable, meaning it's unending, it's boundless. He said, he gives strength to the weary, and to him who lacks might, he increases power. Remember what I said that word comfort meant? When it said, with strength, the person of the Holy Spirit, to make the tough decisions in life, to make the right stand for the right reason, putting Him first. He says, though the youth, you will grow weary. Maybe not physically, immediately, but emotionally, spiritually, you'll grow weak. And the evil one will come alongside of you at that time and whisper in your ear something that sounds right, but isn't. Like Pilgrim's Progress, to get you off the path. But the scripture says, though the youth grow weary and tired, and the vigorous men stumble badly, yet those who wait on the Lord. See, sometimes we think that the decision has to be made now. Got to do it now. I've got a deadline. The end of the month's coming. The beginning of the next month's coming. The 15th's coming. We got to make a decision now. And that means what we're doing is we're putting ourselves in our own pressure cooker to make a bad decision. And we're trying to make it better by saying it has to be made now rather than waiting. I know people that told me story after story, and I've experienced this in life. At the very time of the need, God shows up. Hebrews chapter 4 says that Christ was tempted as all men are tempted, yet without sin. And the very next verse after that, it says, therefore, having this great confidence in this one that was tempted yet without sin, says, therefore, let us run boldly to the throne of grace in our time of need to receive help. Another way to say it, and literally what it says there, is let us run boldly to the throne of grace to receive help in the nick of time. You see, God's never late. We just think that He's late. those who wait on the Lord, the scripture says, those who wait on the Lord will gain new strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not get tired. And they will walk and not become weary. Because he who is in you is greater than he who is in this world. Again, we stand on the feet, on the shoulders of other people who come before us that have lived and died for the name of Jesus. And we sometimes don't think that that's really required of us. And in Western culture, yeah, you're probably not going to die for the name of Jesus. You might be ridiculed or mocked for the name of Jesus or for living the life that you think Jesus wants to be. But don't cave. Stand firm. Stand firm. There'll be times when pride will come and you'll say, I got this. That's one of them famous phrases these days. I got this. I remind you that Deuteronomy 8:18 says this, but you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the power to make wealth. Not only are we created in his image, meaning that we're rational, that we have a sense of morality, but he has given us a disposition toward ruling over the environment that we're in. And sometimes we take for granted that he gives us those cognitive powers in the first place. And it's not until they're gone, until we make that realization. And by that time, it's too late. It's God who gives us the capacity to reason, some better than others, obviously. Because I'm here, right? But he's the one that gives us just the basic capacity and then the gifts that bless us above the basic capacity. And he gives us the power to earn wealth. Nothing wrong with wealth, folks. Matter of fact, the scripture says, you know, wealth is great. It can be used for great and mighty things. But to worship wealth and to make wealth the object of life, that's sin. As a matter of fact, when we do it God's way, wealth takes on a whole different perspective. As a matter of fact, the writer of Proverbs, again, probably Solomon, says this in verse 22 of chapter 10. He says, it is the blessing of the Lord that makes rich. Same word for wealth. And he adds no sorrow to it. See, you can be rich beyond compare and have a penniless bank account and have joy. You can be rich beyond compare and have all the cares that end up in anxiety and misery. When we do it the Lord's way, when we put him first, he makes things right. And what we become satisfied with is what he always wanted for us in the first place. I know a few things about some of you young people that I probably didn't really realize that I knew except for the passing of my wife. It's a hard place out there today to be single. It's tough. And when you're almost 60, it's not any easier. And we'll think sometimes at 20 that we're running out of time, or 24 we're running out of time, or 26 we're running out of time. What about 58? What about 60? Trust in the Lord. Wait on the Lord. Put him first in all things. He's the one that gives riches and blessings, adding no sorrows to them. Again, trust in the Lord with all your heart, putting him first in all things. I said a lot today, maybe too much for some of you. Hopefully some of you out here have went back to that day, to the beginning. Maybe some of you are lamenting. That's okay. Take it from me, and I know very well, God redeems broken people. God can redeem a broken life. God can redeem anything given to Him. And I want to encourage both these graduates and you that are here today to take what was said and understand it is just as applicable to everyone that we know, because we're all broken people in many respects. We all need to be redeemed, to be refined, and to be made more like Jesus. And it begins with putting first things first. I'm going to do something different for the invitation today. Praise team's going to be seated. You'll be there. You can sit right there. And we're going to watch a video. I'm going to be down front. If you want to talk, I'll be down front. But if not, just watch the video and think about the theme and the words to the video. They'll be on the screen with the video. After the video, I have a word of prayer. We'll be dismissed. And the graduates will come up. And then you can greet them and congratulate them right here up front after the video.